So, we have some people not speaking French in the room, so I will do my talk in English, or maybe in Franglish, I don't know, because of my terrible English accent, you know. Here we are almost all, I guess, managing production environments. And in production, we have incidents. It happens, it will happen again. And the important thing to think about is how should we react when it happens, and how do we make sure that it does not happen again. I'm Mathieu Corbin, I'm working at Conto as a SRE. You can check my blog, it's in French, my articles, mcorbin.fr. You can find me on Twitter as well, and this is my picture here. It's me. But on GitHub, Twitter, and so on, it's always the avatar I use. I work so at Conto, it's a French company, but that is now in multiple countries in Europe. And it's a finance application, so we provide bank accounts, cards, accounting, or things like that. You can check the website, conto.com, if you are interested. So this was me at work a few months ago, doing stuff, maybe Terraform, writing Terraform modules, maybe. And I was on call. And suddenly, what happens? I start to receive alerts from OpsGenie, multiple alerts related to Kubernetes on one staging cluster. We have several staging clusters, and on one, things were going bad. So what were the symptoms? Applications could not be deployed anymore on this cluster. A lot of pods, including over-provisioner pods that we use to have more capacity than what is asked by developer, were unable to be scheduled. We had also pods crashing, like for example the external secret operator that we are using to manage secrets on our clusters. And we also noticed request throttling on Kubernetes-related components on clients, for example, Argo CD. So one cluster was completely unusable for developers. And of course, it's an issue. The first thing we do at Conto when something happens, an incident happens, is declaring the incident. At Conto, we have a way of working that is called the Conto way. It's heavily inspired from the lean management method. And for incidents, we also have a clear procedure. And the first thing we should do is declare it. Everyone at Conto can declare an incident at any time. When I say everyone, it can be really everyone from the intern to the CTO, and not even tech people. What I will show you here is also the method that we'll use by HR, by the legal team, or marketing, and so on, for their own incidents that are not related to tech. But it's the same thing, the same procedure, the same documents, and the same concepts. We declare an incident using Slack. We have a channel named Incident Report. You just have to type slash incident into it, and it will open a form. It will trigger a workflow with where you can put your incident name and an incident description. You click on Submit, and as you can see, I have a message that is created on this channel. Saying a new incident reported by Mathieu Corbin. It's me. Staging Kubernetes Cluster 3 is misbehaving. We have performance issues and so on. And automatically, we have a Slack channel created for this incident. And the name, as you can see, is the current date and the name of the incident. This Slack channel is created, contains some links, interesting links. For example, we have a link to a Notion page that I will show you after, that is also automatically created. We have the name of the incident commander. I will talk about it also later. It's me in that case. And we also tell to people to create a new meet, for example, to discuss for people involved in the incident. And we also have a link, for example, did something happen recently, production and staging. It's a Grafana dashboard that contains a lot of information about events on the platform. It can be useful sometimes to just open this pane and see, ah yes, we had this deployment, this infrastructure change, or things like that, to quickly try to find if something was done recently or not. So, as I said, we have one Slack channel created and also one Notion page. We use Notion for all of our documentation, and so we have a page created automatically on Notion for the incident, then people can join the Slack channel and start investigating. As I said, we have one incident commander, and the goal of the commander is to coordinate things. The priority when you have an incident is to mitigate it. It's really the top priority is make sure that the incident is over. And the commander will handle communication, so make sure everything is clear for everyone. Because usually on an incident, you have people from multiple teams, SRE, backend, even product people joining and saying, what should I tell to customers? People from the support maybe that starts receiving complaints and they should know what to answer. So the commander should coordinate and make sure that everything is clear for everyone, for every team. He should also, if needed, ask questions, ask to reformulate if something is unclear from one team. Prioritize actions because not everyone is used to manage to work under pressure during incidents. It can happen that in a tech team, someone freeze, you know, does not want to take actions or is completely lost and so on. So the commander is here to say, okay, let's do that, let's try that. Yes, you can do this action, let's try and so on. So to make people, to unblock them if needed. And the commander is also responsible to complete the Notion page that was automatically created and do the follow-up after the incident. The Notion page. The goal of this Notion page is to centralize all information about the incident. This is what it looks like. I mean, part of it, I will show the rest after. The title of my page is my incident name that I declared in Slack. And I have a lot of fields, as you can see, that I should complete as an incident commander. For example, the start time and when it's over, the end time of the incident, the number of customer impacted, the money at risk. As I said, we are a financing institution, so sometimes you can lose money during incidents. The number, for example, of transfers impacted, because it's a transfers for a bank is something super important. And automatically, I have a severity that will be computed from this field. This one is also interesting. You know, what is the impact for customers? No or slight disturbance for the customer. In my case, it's staging, so no impact for customers. I don't care. No impact for customers, but for developers. but for example, if user cannot login anymore at all on the platform, it's a huge impact for customers. And from that, we compute a severity, 1, 2, or 3. You can see also things like the commanders, the response team, who is involved in the incident, how it was detected, automatic alert in my case, but we also have a human alert here. If it happens, it should never happen. If it happens, we will see what we do after. The root cause, feature impacted, stack, tech team, and so on. Then, the commander will also complete some sections on this page. The summary of the incident, so description. For example, in my case, what is happening? The staging 3 cluster, Kubernetes cluster is misbehaving, and so on. What is the impact? The developers cannot work anymore on this environment. Mitigation, how did we react? First, the causes. So, of course, when you create an incident, you don't know yet, but when it's over, you go back on the page and you complete it. So the causes here were because someone deployed Crossplane on this cluster, and it installed almost 1,000 custom resource definitions at the same time, and EKS crashed immediately. The control plane just crashed and gave up. And at the same time, you also had an issue on this cluster. We reached the maximum number of nodes on one of our auto-scaling group, because we were using back in the past EKS with regular EC2 auto-scaling groups, and we have a max size, and we hit the max size, so spots could not be scheduled anymore. Now we use Carpenter, it's awesome. Mitigation, how did we react? We deleted cross-plane, and so the control plane went back, and we scaled the cluster. Then we have a timeline that is completed during the incident by the commander. So we see when it started, then the investigation. So after 10 minutes, we found that it was cross-plane, the issue. We did it cross-plane, and then we noticed also that the cluster was full. 60 instances deployed, and the maximum was the same. So we scaled to 80. And now, at 2 hours after, it was 1 hour after, it was stable, and we fixed the thing. Thanks to this page, everyone in the company can just open it and understand what is happening, what was the impact, who was on the incident. So it's very nice to have this page to give it even to people, to other teams. if they need to read it. So the incident is mitigated, but what you want is to make sure that it does not happen again, never. And we use incidents at Conto for continuous improvement. We really use them to improve the platform all the time, and we do this thing, the PDCA for all incidents. What is a PDCA? It's a plan, do, check, act. So the goal of the PDCA, we do it as a meeting with people that were involved in the incident. We frame the problem, we define a clear problem statement about what was happening. We describe what happened, so usually it's the incident timeline. We find incident root causes, and we make sure that the root causes are solved. But the goal is not to, for example, to have a 2 months project created from a PDCA, is to have small actions that mitigate, that make sure that they can be implemented in 1 day, for example, and make sure that this specific incident cannot happen again. We check that the actions work as expected, and then we do an act. We apply them to the rest of our systems and the rest of the company. So I will give you an example. On the main Notion incident page, we can create a new PDCA. It's a dedicated Notion database, and it will create another page for the PDCA. So here I created, I have owners, an owner field, participants, and a status. This new Notion page contains the problem statement. So the problem statement should be super clear, is what is happening, what happened, what were the consequences. So in my case, one Kubernetes cluster was misbehaving. Consequence, a lot of feature branches, so it's a dynamic environment for developers, were not working anymore. We don't try to find the root causes in the problem statement. I will not talk about cross-plane or about Amazon auto scaling groups and so on in the problem statement. It's just what was happening and what was the consequences. Then we'll do a root cause analysis. It's the most difficult part for me of the PDCA. For that, we use the 5 whys method. We have 2 sections on this part. First is occurrence. What did the problem occur? No detection. Why didn't we detect it sooner? For example, if you have a human alert, detecting an incident and not an automatic system, you can be sure that we are lacking alerting and that you will have something on non-detection. So in our case, we start by occurrence. The Kubernetes control plane API server was lagging and it caused Kubernetes controllers to crash. So it was the case for internal secrets or things like that. Why? Crossplane was installed on this cluster for testing purposes, and the installation created it was 880 CRDs, and it caused the API server to fail. Why? Crossplane was deployed directly on staging and not on our test environment, let's say. It was because we have another environment before staging, which is less critical for our tests. It's okay if it fails. For staging, we should not make it fail. So here, the test was done directly in staging. No detection. Why didn't we detect it sooner? So in this part, we will work on the auto-scaling group part of the incident. We hit the maximum size of the Amazon auto-scaling group. This prevented new pods to be scheduled. Why? We had a lot of branches, or a lot of pods, let's say, deployed on this cluster, and we didn't detect that. We hit the limit. Why? We introduced a regression a few months ago on the metric that prevents us to reach 100%. The alert was wrong. Basically, we had an alert, but it was wrong because the metric was incorrect due to a regression a few months ago. Now we have our root causes, 2 root causes. We can implement countermeasures. The first one here is fix the alert for the problematic auto-scaling group. Of course, we had an incorrect alert. We fix it. Each countermeasure has a check date, so at this date, we should really try to see if the countermeasure is working as expected. So for example, what is my check in my case? The alert was executing in staging to see its results. So we can take the alert that we fixed, apply it to the incident time frame, and see that, yes, we trigger this alert during the incident time frame. So we do the check, and then we do an act, is make sure that this alert exist and is correctly defined for all environments and all auto-scaling groups that we manage at Conto, not only on Kubernetes, for example, all auto-scaling groups. Because here, we only did the fix for one environment, for example, The check will verify that the fix is working. But now we should make sure that all Kubernetes clusters, and even, as I said, autoscaling group outside of Kubernetes are handled. Another root cause, what we decided is to allow only some custom resource definitions to be deployed. So now people have to whitelist custom resource definition groups. In order to deploy them, we use Kiverno for that. And so no one can apply 1,000 custom resource definitions in production and make our production fail, because we need a merge request to whitelist them. So same thing, countermeasure, we implement it using Kiverno. We verify what is the check. I create a CRD that is not whitelisted. It fails. Cool. Act. I deploy the rule on all environments. And so this is the method we use. And it's super nice because the procedure for incidents is clear to everyone. It's always the same. We have a good tooling. As you can see, the Slack channel, the incident pages, and so on are created automatically with good templates and so on. We are doing continuous improvements. Every time we have a problem, not only incidents, we are doing PDCA. And we repeat that all the time. If we have a deep issue, for example, we had several incidents at Conto on auto-scaling groups. We will not use the PDCA method to solve this issue because, reworking how we work on Kubernetes for our Kubernetes nodes is a lot of work. It cannot be done in one day. It's a 2 months project, maybe. The PDCA is not for that. For that, we will use Kaizen and S3. It's another methodologies to do this kind of project. So the PDCA is really for small tasks that solve the problem right now. But then we use the outputs of PDCA as signals, let's say, as data to build bigger projects. Doing a good PDCA requires training because it's common for people to not find the right root causes. I will give you an example. Recently, we had an incident in production. And during the PDCA, the root cause of the PDCA for the people that were doing it was we didn't do enough QA, manual QA in staging. Because we didn't detect the incident in production, so they thought we should have tested more in staging. But actually, it was not the right root cause. The root cause is why we didn't detect it when it was starting to fail in production. It took 1 day to detect the issue in production. That things were failing, the root cause is not more QA, because it can happen for another reason. The root cause is we don't have alerts for this component. So it requires training, so we do training at Conto on how to handle and manage PDCS and incidents, and it's super important. Thank you. A few links to Conto if you are interested by it. And if you have questions, you can send me an email or we can discuss this afternoon. If we don't really do postmortems because our postmortems is we don't provide postmortems to customers basically. They are not public. I mean, but for us, we use the PDCA. I mean, our postmortem is the incident page and the PDCA. Usually, we don't write more postmortems. Or maybe we write them sometimes for partners where we have SLAs and so on. But for most of the incidents, we don't write postmortems because we use the PDCA as a postmortem, and we share the PDCA if needed.
Do you have a strategy about the chaos engineering? Do you use it in your?
Alors, we don't really use chaos engineering today, but we start kind of doing it. For example, we noticed that we had a lot of issues during Kubernetes upgrades because some applications were not built to support rollout, for example, handling signals, to create signals wrong or things like that. So what we do now is that we have a TTL on nodes, so we have a 24 hours TTL thanks to Carpenter, for example. So things are rebuilt all the time, but we don't really do chaos engineering at it in production today. It's something that I would like to push because indeed, often, we need to exercise to make things fail. To detect issues on application, but we don't do it on a regular basis today, let's say.
And game days in Ninja.
What?
Game days.
Game days?
Yes, game days, which is like
ah.
You took a day where you're gonna break something.
No, no, we don't do it. On staging, sometimes people are experimenting, but not in production directly. Yes, you can change the commander, indeed,
okay.
Because indeed by default is the one who created the incident,
mm-hmm.
but it can change at any time, even for the because indeed the commander should do the follow-up. So the commander is expected to do, to mm-hmm. gather people to do the PDCA and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And as you said, sometimes it does not make sense that it's not someone that understands the tech, for example, to be the commander.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, often we set the commander as someone from the team that is mainly involved in the incident.
Mm. And about reporting the timeline of the incident,
mm.
Do you have two person working in pair so that one can deep dive on the incident? For example, if it takes like more than one day, hopefully not, but it may happen. And someone that taking all the timelines, commands, inputs, or
yes, usually we have multiple people involved in incidents,
mm-hmm.
not only the commander, except for very small incidents.
Mm-hmm.
And what we do sometimes is that we don't complete the timeline right now in the document, in the Notion page, but we make sure during the incident, where things are completely on fire,
mm-hmm.
to log every action on Slack. And like that, we can rebuild the timeline from the Slack channel. So the commander role sometimes is also that.
Mm-hmm.
The commander is on meet with a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
And every time someone is doing something, the commander is just writing in a Slack, pressing enter. And then the timeline can be built, can be rebuilt on the document
mm-hmm.
a bit later if needed. So in that case, we invite in our Google Meet, or in the incident channel, people from the support team or the legal team or another teams. We gather people from other teams. Usually, all teams have people available that are kind of on call or duty, let's say. We even have at Conto, for example, a manager. Managers are on call. So it means that if I'm on call and I have something failing in the middle of the night, and it's impacting customers a lot, and I have to, as a tech, I cannot, it's out of my responsibility to take huge business decisions, like cutting a service or things like that. So we call a manager, it can be the C-level or head of or adulto, that will say, yes, you can do it. And so usually we do it that way, we ping people from other teams.
Summarize it in a way that they can take the decision.
If it impacts customer, usually they understand it because indeed I will not say, for example, to someone that is non-tech, Kubernetes cluster is failing or things like that. I will say, for example, people cannot send transfers anymore or things like that, that everyone understands. And by the way, if you need to define SLOs on your teams, it's really nice to have SLOs that are business oriented, not tech oriented, because they can be understood by everyone. Everyone here understands we cannot send SEPA transfers, or you cannot pay by card, which will never happen. but everyone understands that, and so this is how we talk with non-tech people. Or usually at Conto, at least in the tech side, managers are from the tech world. But if you need to talk with people from other teams, like customer success and so on, PMs, we will just say what is the impact for customers. And if I change that, customer will not be able to do that. And it's clear for them.
Yeah, like we were saying, like to ping other teams, for example, if, I don't know, we need to decide or other team needs to do something. Like, is there some kind of like catalog with info from other teams or?
We have, so on most tech teams, also some non-tech teams, we have every day someone that is on duty, let's say, and that is available to join on this kind of incidents. And so on Slack, for example, we can ping this person directly with, for example, SRE duty, you know, at SRE duty, or things like that. And or if no one answers, we ping the whole team. So, and then if someone is available, someone will join. And but we always find someone basically during the day, and during the night it's on regular on call. I mean, it's people on call shifts, and so we can call them through Opsgenie.
Okay. And also, like this in terms of impact, because sometimes it's custom impact, but sometimes maybe it's system impact, like exponentially growing or something. Like, is there a way? Some strategy to like, estimate what is the impact. Like,
but
as a tech, I don't know like about how much money we're losing.
Ah, yes. So for that, indeed, for the impact, for example, money at risk, it's things that are when the incident happens, you don't know about it, but then an analysis will be done by the people that know how to do it. So usually people from the backend teams that manage the service, maybe with the help of some of the support and things like that, and then they can estimate the impact in terms of money. But indeed, the Notion document, everything cannot be completed right during the incident. Sometimes it requires a bit of an analysis in order to see if how much customers are impacting. Same thing, if we want an exact number, it's hard to compute on the fly. It's something that will be done after, but just by estimating it, we can usually compute the right incident severity, and we have KPIs on that, on in severity, make sure that we don't have save one incidents at all. Save three, they are not that bad, because save three, that's why we are doing PDCA on severity three incidents, on all incidents, because save three are the ones that will become save one in the future. So if you do PDCA all the time, or even a small thing, you improve the platform all the time. Mm-hmm. So that's why it's a nice methodology, I think.
But so I think on staging there would never be a S1,
right? On?
For that. Like S1?
Yes.
On staging it
would
be S1.
Usually, yes, because no customer impacted. But maybe we can also override the severity. Managers can. If, for example, no one can deploy in production during 1 week, I guess it will become a save one, you know.
What are the statuses of your incidents? Like open, description, completed?
Yes, we have, it's ongoing, let's say, mm-hmm. Mitigated, resolved, and then post-mortem completed.
Okay.
Post-mortem, so it's PDCA, the PDCA.
Okay, no more questions. Thanks a lot again, Mathieu.
Welcome.